God, we truly are grateful for your word this day, for how it touches our lives. Lord, I pray that the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts here today be holy and acceptable to you, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Today is one of my favorite scriptures, and I love that the lectionary hasn't come up, but this is by far one of my favorite pieces of Paul's writing, if not my favorite. It comes from Romans chapter 8, verses 26 through 39. Let us be attentive to a word from the apostle. Likewise, the Spirit helps us in our weakness. For we do not know how to pray as we ought, but that very Spirit intercedes with sighs too deep for words. And God, who searches the heart, knows what is the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for the saints according to the will of God. We know that all things work together for good for those who love God, who are called according to His purpose. For those whom He foreknew, He also predestined to be conformed to the image of His Son, in order that He might be the firstborn within a large family. And those whom He predestined, He also called. And those whom He called, He also justified. And those whom He justified, He also glorified. What then are we to say about these things? If God is for us, who is against us? He who did not withhold His own Son, but gave Him up for all of us, will He not with Him also give us everything? Who will bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? It is Jesus Christ, who died, yes, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who indeed intercedes for us. Who will separate us from the love of Christ? Will hardship or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? As it is written, for your sake we are being killed all day long. We are accounted as sheep to be slaughtered. No. In all these things we are more than conquerors through Him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. This is the word of our Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Like I said, this is by far one of my favorite texts. And it has been written on my heart for a very long time because it is comforting. It is comforting to know that nothing, there's not a thing in this world that can separate us. And this is the gospel truth. This is the very truth that guides us, that holds us up. If someone ever asks, what is the gospel all about? Now, you don't have to quote this scripture, but you can paraphrase. Someone says, what is the gospel? And you say, who? Who can bring a charge against me? Only God. Only God can judge me. And God has already judged me through Christ Jesus and has judged me and shown me love. And beyond that, who can separate me from that love? Nothing, no one, ever, anything in all of creation can ever separate me from love. You want the gospel truth? That's the gospel truth. That's the message of the gospel, is that there is nothing ever in this world, because of the actions that God willfully took in Christ Jesus, that can separate any of us from God's divine love. There's nothing that can remove that love. And beyond that, we know that God is at work in our lives, because that love is never separated. In distress, in persecution, in joy, in fun, all of that, God is present and at work, and God is working through all things to bring about the glory in us. Chapter 8 is overly full. Chapter 8 of Romans, it has more than we possibly could preach in probably 10, I could preach in probably 10 sermons up here, but I'm going to try to do it as much justice as I can. It's the culmination. I know there's 4 more chapters after this in the book of Romans, but really, this is the climax of what Paul has been working towards. This. And for those of us who are loved, love God, all things are at work for glory and for God's goodness. And that's tough. It's tough to remember because, for lack of a better term, sometimes all goes to hell in a handbasket real quick. It starts to go south real fast. Debt, foreclosure, whatever it is, death, struggles. It all begins to seem like it's all falling apart. But God is there in it. And it's hard for us to see it in that moment because we can't see the forest for the trees most times. Because we're so focused on how bad it is, we don't ever get the chance to see how God is using whatever that is, that darkness just before dawn, to bring about something amazing, something grand and glorious. And it's hard. It is so hard for us to see that. But Paul reminds us, God is working and at work for us and in us to bring about great things. It is by far one of the hardest concepts, in my opinion, to really grasp onto, because we see the problem, but we often miss how God is working. Now, then we take a step back, we look back 2-3 years later, we go, oh, God was in that. God was working in that, because hindsight is always 20/20. Our frail human minds struggle to see that God is present. But our God, the one that we come to this place week in and week out to worship, and the one who promises that he will never leave us and promises that he will always be at work in our lives, is there and is present. And doesn't seem like it in the hardest of times, but Paul reminds us and says, God is there. God is the one initiating the contact and the work and doing it. God is the one who initiated the life of Jesus Christ and sent him and then gave everything so that we could have everything. It's hard in our discomfort and our pain to see God working and moving. It's hard when those moments and those feelings keep us going to see that we are being transformed into more faithful people. Those moments, those hard moments, they are really the moments that transform us. They make us people who can serve more fully, love more completely, and to know who we are and whose we are. And Paul's reminding us of that, that God is at work, even though it feels like God is so far away. Even though we can't see it, God is still working. Even when we don't have the words, Paul says, even though we don't know how to pray, the Spirit is there guiding us. Even when we don't have the words to speak, the Spirit is there. Paul tells us that when we don't have the eloquent words, when we don't have those words to bow our heads in the pastoral prayer and use fancy words and say all those grand things, that the Spirit is there with sighs too deep. In some translations, it groans too deep. God knows even our guttural noises and knows what we need and is in them with sighs too deep for longing. When we feel ill-equipped, when we feel like we don't have the gifts and talents, when we feel like we aren't capable, God is there. When we feel like we can't pray, God is there, God is working, God is the searcher of hearts and knows what we need before we need it. Paul's climax is to remind us that God is ever present and nothing in this this whole world or any other world will ever change that fact. And it is God who moves inside of us. It is God who pushes us and guides us and knows our inmost thoughts, which could be good, could lead to a little bit of trouble. But hey, God's there in it. God's moving in us. Romans 8:31 is the encouragement we all need when we doubt God's love for us or feel distant from God. It reminds us that God, who loved us enough to give His own Son, won't withhold other good things from us. It also reminds us that absolutely nothing can separate us from God's amazing love. God, what could separate me from your love? Not a failed test, not a broken promise, not a hurtful insult. What could tear me away from you? The lure of popularity or unnatural high? No. If you are on my side, who could be against me? Not a vengeful peer or someone who has turned against me. What situation could divide you and me? Not depression, not guilt, not anger. No, in all these things, I know I am never alone because you, God, conquered sin, despair, and even death itself through your love. Lord, I am convinced that nothing, absolutely nothing, will ever separate you from me. Nothing will separate us. No labels that our world puts upon us, smart, dumb, untalented, unpopular, mean, rude, those labels that the world wants to put on us, they don't separate us from God. No. Nothing, not race, not poverty or wealth, not dementia or Alzheimer's, not youth, not gender, not the site of town that you were brought up on or live on now, not the gifts you have or don't have, not even our own comfort or discomfort. Not even those moments when we feel so uncomfortable, God is still there. John Donne likened the love of God to a circle, seeing that it was endless. It rules victoriously over death and life alike, over powers in heaven and on earth. And since it is love's nature to bind the beloved to it, Paul is convinced, and after the chapters of Romans, he might expect we would be as well. But nothing in all of this creation can separate us. And the best part about that is when we realize it. When we realize that there is absolutely nothing in this world that can separate me or you from the love of God, we become something greater. We become something better. Better. We become something better. Because Paul says, in all of this, we are more than conquerors. This language would have struck a pure chord to the Romans. To the people in Rome, because what they saw was society of conquerors, the largest empire that had ever existed, ruled by the sword, people thrown into pits for fun to be eaten by lions, conquered, destroyed, and take over. That was the way to be. That was the appropriate way. But Paul says, oh, in all of this, we are more than conquerors. We are something better. We have more power than the one who conquers or wants to conquer. In all this, we become, instead of conquerors, we become partners. Instead of people who tell others what they need and the best way to do it, we listen and we find out what they need and how we can hold them up and how we can make their lives better. Instead of haters, we become lovers. Become people who love relentlessly. Instead of dominators, we become the servants. We become the showers of the inseparable love of God that we know we have and is here for this world. I saw this. And I'm not going to share all of it because they're going to share it in next week. But I saw this week. From 13-year-olds, from Colton Steckley and Caleb Koch and Carly Kermeens, and oh no, I don't know Lexi's last name, and then Emma Landenkruger Elk. I saw this week. They were more than conquerors. They went to St. Paul. Now granted, Emma loves St. Paul, so it really wasn't out of her comfort zone to go there, but there were five 13-year-olds who had never left home. And if they had left home, mom or dad was with them. And we went. We loaded up a 12-passenger van and we went. And I saw them in the most uncomfortable situation for a 13-year-old, spending time, well, you two, in a nursing home. Daily. Spending time with people who had strokes and memory loss, dementia and Alzheimer's, and these kids, the first day, were like, whoa, I don't do old people. One of them was like, I really don't do old people. Now, this nursing home, this facility, nursing facility, assisted living facility, it's a lot like the castle. A lot like Island Ridge, so it wasn't one of those very, very uncomfortable ones that do exist, but they showed. I'll tell you about Emma. Emma and Emma. There was an older African-American woman named Emma who had suffered a very bad stroke. Her eyesight was fading, and so we were playing bingo, because that's what you do at these places. And Emma sat with her and helped her see, and she would point to the number B9, whatever, and she would just point, and then Emma would put her little token on there, and she talked to her, and she loved her. In Emma's life, not the young one, not our teenager, but the older one, I'm sure as an African-American woman of that age, she has suffered many things. As she has gotten older, the visits maybe have become less. The connections have become less. As she has a stroke, her faculties, her body, her functions are less. Being African-American of that age, she suffered racism and hate just by the color of her skin. This woman has went through more than most of us can even imagine in terms of reason to understand and think that God isn't present. But then, for 4 or 5 days, a young, white teenager from Iowa sits with her, does music therapy, plays bingo with her, and reminds this woman and reminds us all that there is nothing that can separate us from the love of God. See, instead of going and saying, you need Jesus, she said, I'll be Jesus. Instead of going and saying, this is what you need to be whole, she said, I will be those parts that help you become whole. Instead of conquering, she loved. Showed an inseparable love. And Emma is not the only one, but that's just the story I'm going to tell you because it's the one that sat with me and sits with me. I can tell you about Colton Steckley sitting and talking with a woman as uncomfortable as he was, going, no old people. But they talk. We can talk about the small African-American children in the mornings and the Hmong children, the immigrants who they play dodgeball with. Dodgeball. That's not anything to do with Jesus. It's everything to do with Jesus. It's everything to do with the love of God that none of us can be separated from. We've seen it. That's who we're called to be. That's what this scripture says. We no longer are conquerors. We no longer are the ones who go in and say, you need Jesus, but we have the opportunity to share that love that we know is so deeply embedded in us and nothing can separate us from with the world. brothers and sisters, you're not conquerors. You're not tellers of the word, you're doers and livers of the word. And may you be so filled with the knowledge that nothing can separate you from that love that God has put into you and gives you daily. That you give that to the world. And you let the world know.